Complications in Early Pregnancy Part 3. In this third installation of Complications in Early Pregnancy, we will be focusing on the next commonest presenting complaint in early pregnancy, which is that of nausea and vomiting. The learning objectives are to learn to diagnose and assess the severity of common complications in early pregnancy, to provide a list of differential diagnoses for common complaints in early pregnancy, and to learn to manage these complications in early pregnancy. Up to 50% of all pregnant women will experience symptoms of nausea and vomiting in early pregnancy. The commonest etiology is hyperemesis gravidarum. However, other differential diagnoses need to be considered and excluded. These include gastrointestinal disease, endocrine disorders such as hyperthyroidism, sepsis, gestational trophoblastic disease as previously mentioned, and even intracranial lesions. Hyperemesis gravidarum. The incidence of this is somewhere between 0.1 to 1% of all pregnancies. Risk factors include young maternal age, high body weight, nulliparity, multiple gestational pregnancy, previous history of hyperemesis gravidarum. Clinical features include onset of symptoms, usually in the first trimester of pregnancy, severe and persistent nausea and vomiting, which may result in the patient being unable to maintain adequate hydration and nutrition. Hydration status should be regularly assessed. Investigations should be performed to assess the patient's state of hydration, as well as any electrolyte disturbances. A renal panel and urinary ketones should be mandatorily performed. An ultrasound should be carried out to assess fetal viability. Differential diagnoses should be ruled out, and certain investigations such as a thyroid panel, inflammatory markers, serum beta ECG, liver function test, and even neurological imaging should be performed. Hyperemesis gravidarum may result in significant maternal and fetal morbidity and mortality. Maternal complications are mainly related to vitamin deficiencies or electrolyte disturbances. Severe vitamin B1 deficiency may lead to Wernicke's encephalopathy. The lack of vitamin B1 results in lactic acidosis, brain edema, oxidative stress, inflammation, and white matter damage. The patient usually presents with neurological features such as ophthalmoplegia, diplopia, nystagmus, ataxia, and confusion. Untreated, the patient may progress to Korsakoff psychosis associated with neurological features such as amnesia, which may be anterograde or retrograde, confabulation, lack of insight, and apathy. Hyponatremia may be associated with clinical features of lethargy, seizures, and even respiratory arrest. Severe hyponatremia or its rapid correction can lead to central pontine malignosis. Other vitamin deficiencies such as B12 or B6 may ensue. Excessive retching may also result in Mallory-Weiss tears and esophageal bleeding. Fetal complications include lower birth weight fetuses and even fetal loss. The management of patients with hyperemesis gravidarum depends on the severity. If the patient is having recalcitrant episodes of nausea and vomiting, uncontrolled by outpatient treatment, or resulting in inability to partake orally, admission for inpatient care and intravenous support should be offered. Rehydration is key. This may be via the oral route if the patient is able to tolerate orally, or via an intravenous fluid drip with electrolyte correction. Antiemetic agents should be prescribed. These include dopamine antagonists such as metoclopramide, antihistamines, phenothiazines, and selective serotonin antagonists. Gastroprotective agents such as H2 receptor blockers may be supplemented to relieve symptomatic dyspepsia. In cases of severe refractory hyperemesis, corticosteroids and assisted feeding techniques may be necessary.